Okay, so this problem is a follow-up on a problem that we considered for a batch reactor using differential kinetic analysis in order to determine the overall reaction order gamma and the reaction rate constant K. And in this screencast, instead of using differential analysis or purely differential analysis, we're going to take the information that we got from the differential analysis, which was that gamma was approximately equal to 1.93, I think, and K was equal to 2.4 times 10 to the minus 4, and use those as initial guesses in a nonlinear regression in order to solve for the rate. And so we'll see how to do this fairly simply in Excel. If you have a very complicated kinetic expression, then Excel may not be the best way to go, and you may want to use a more robust modeling package. But Excel should work fine for this simple power rate law type expression. So let's go over to Excel. What I've done is I've taken the same data that we looked at last time. So we had, as a function of time, various concentrations of C that we had measured. By a mole balance, we determined the concentration of A, and I've just pasted that over here. Okay, and then what I've done is I've put in a predicted value for CA. And so this is one that's calculated based purely on a model. And so I have a formula in here that predicts CA for a particular model. So let's take a look at this. Okay, where I've taken this expression that we have, and here, just for simplicity, I've raised it to the n instead of the gamma, of dCA dt is equal to negative kCA to some power. That's the power we want to solve for. And we can actually write a general formula for this value of the concentration of A in terms of K and N, which are the two things we're trying to solve for. Okay, and so what I can do is take this formula and put it straight into column here, right, which is what I have for the predicted value of CA, and then reference that wherever I need K and N to values that we're going to change using the solver routine in Excel. Okay, and so the values that I've initially set are the values that we obtained from our differential analysis of 0.00024 and 1.93 for K and N respectively. And then what I do is I compute the predicted concentration of A at those values. I take the difference between what's predicted from the equation and what was obtained from the experimental data and square that difference. And I do that for every data point. And then I sum the squared errors. So this gives me the squared error for each data point. I sum those. And this gives me something that we want to try to minimize using solver. Okay, so we can see it's already pretty low because we've made a good initial guess based on our previous solution to this problem. But this should give us a better model fit since we aren't having to make any calculations of numerical derivatives. So let's go ahead and use the solver routine. And what we're going to do is we're going to set the target cell, the sum of squared errors, equal to a minimum in order to get our best fit. And we'll do that by changing the two cells that control our model fit, which are K and N. All right, so those will be changed. And we're going to set this equal to the value of the target cell. And then subject to the constraints that K, for example, should be a positive number. We could probably think of some other constraints that we put in here. And this becomes a lot more important if you don't have a very good initial guess or if you have a more complicated model. But for this two-parameter model, we should be okay. Okay, and solver is converged on a solution with all constraints satisfied. So we'll keep that solution. We see that we got a little bit of a difference in values. Now N is even closer to 2, so 2.02, and K decreasing a little bit. That results in a very low sum of squared errors. And so now we believe that we have a good fit, a good second order fit for the reaction rate. Okay, now if you recall, okay, one thing we won't talk about this in this screencast, but we'll definitely talk about later on in another screencast, all right, is we've just estimated gamma and K, all right, but we have to do another experiment in order to actually estimate alpha and beta. All right, we can't do that from this single experiment. All right, so the one kind of experiment that we typically would run in addition to this one would be to run with one component in great excess so that it's a constant. And that will allow us to estimate the reaction order of the other component. And once we know the total reaction order and the reaction order of one component, then we can determine the other just by this addition. And so we'll explore how to do this later, but I just wanted to point out that we will need additional experimental data that we'll analyze using very similar techniques so that we can analyze with differential analysis or with this minimization of the sum of squared errors that we've just talked about in order to determine the individual values of alpha and beta.